Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Inna atayna kal kawthar. Fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shanika huwal abtar. Sadaqallahu aliyyul azim. Sisters and brothers, the day of Arafat is a blessed day and it is quickly approaching. Too often, this day of grace comes and goes, and we try to read this dua quickly, this very powerful dua, and we sometimes overlook the opportunity to reflect on its depth and the messages it contains. To that end, we are very fortunate today to have with us respected Sheikh and Dr. Osama Al-Attar to help us dive deeper into this remarkable treasure, this dua of the day of Arafat from Imam Hussein alayhi salam. Before we get started, you can ask questions on Menti, and I think the Menti code should be showing up on your screen throughout the program, and at the end of the address, we will take your questions through Menti. So feel free at any time to put your questions through. Now, before we go in, I know that we all know and have had a lot of chance to, you know, we know Dr. Osama Al-Attar very well. He's a respected member of our extended community, and we've heard his majlises on many occasions. He's a reciter. He recites very heart-rendering duas and letmias, majlises, and workshops like this. And while we all know them, just in case you don't, I'll just share a little bit of background before we turn it over to our respected Sheikh. He completed his Bachelor of Science in Chemistry and went on further to complete his PhD also in chemistry at the University of British Columbia in Vancouver at the Simon Fraser University. And beyond his secular studies, Sheikh had an opportunity to also study under some of our great Maharajas and Alims, including Ayatollah Sayyid Murtaza Al-Qazwini and Sayyid Mustafa Al-Qazwini. Without further ado, I'll turn it over to Sheikh to begin the discussion. And thank you for joining us this day and blessing us with your presence.
Thank you very much. Jazakumullahu khaira. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Walhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu ala Muhammadin wa alihi al-tahirin. My dear brothers and sisters, mu'minin and mu'minat, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Inshallah, over the course of the next hour or so, we will shed light on some aspects of Dua Arafah. We will begin our discussion, inshallah, with the significance of dua. Then we will talk about Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam and dua. And then we will discuss 5 points from Dua Arafah. And then we will have the conclusion, inshallah. During the time, please note down any questions. And then after the discussion, we will be happy to address some of your questions and concerns, inshallah. So the beginning of the discussion, dua. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ud'uni astajib lakum, in Surah Ghafir. And then he said, Inna alladhina yastakbiruna an ibadati, sayadukhuluna jahannama dakhirin. Invoke me, call me, and I will respond to you. Ud'uni astajib lakum. And then Allah says, indeed, those who are too arrogant to worship me. Yani Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala associates dua with ibadah. And that's where the hadith comes from. Al-du'a'u mukhul ibadah. Mukh literally means brain. And the brain of the individual is like the control center. It's like the essence of the individual. So we can translate this hadith as the essence of ibadah is dua, submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, O people, ya ayyuhan nasu antumul fuqara'u ila Allah. You are the ones who are in need, in poverty, in deprivation, in need of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves being invoked, called, asked. And we have a hadith that says Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala discourages the mu'mineen from insisting upon each other with their needs. But he encourages them to insist upon him with their needs. Meaning that sometimes you might need something from somebody. You ask him once, ask him twice, and if you feel that he's not responding, then you're not encouraged to continue insisting, because it may cause maybe that individual to feel turned away from you. When he sees your number, maybe on the phone, he's like, oh, he's calling me again on that issue. So it may cause that rift, and hence it's discouraged to insist on people. However, he encourages it upon himself, meaning that when you have a need with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, continue asking for that need over and over and over again. Okay, so this is something about dua. And finally, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi, a man came to him and he said, Ya Rasulullah, is my Lord near so I speak to him softly, or is he far so that I speak loudly? This person possibly may have been new to Islam and may not have realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not physical, he's not materialistic. There is no distance when it comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the physical context. So the ayah was revealed, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وَإِذَا سَأَلَكَ عِبَادِي عَنِّي فَإِنِّي قَرِيبٌ أُجِيبُ دَعْوَةَ الدَّاعِ إِذَا دَعَانِ. In Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah says, when my servants ask you about me, then let them know, tell them that I am near. Near here does not mean near in physical distance. Near means I am fully aware of their needs. So let them, فَلْيَسْتَجِيبُوا لِي, so let them answer me, وَلْيُؤْمِنُوا بِي, and believe in me. So therefore, we should always ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, invoke Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ask him with the certainty, yaqeen, that he will answer you. We learn this from Prophet Zakaria alayhi salam in the Quran, in Surah Maryam, when he asked Allah for a son. In his dua, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, ذِكْرُ رَحْمَةِ رَبِّكَ عَبْدَهُ زَكَرِيَا إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ نِدَاءً خَفِيَّا قَالَ رَبِّ إِنِّي وَهَنَ الْعَظْمُ مِنِّي وَاشْتَعَلَ الرَّأْسُ شَيْبًا وَلَمْ أَكُمْ بِدُعَائِكَ رَبِّ شَقِيَّا. This dua, this part, وَلَمْ أَكُمْ بِدُعَائِكَ رَبِّ شَقِيَّا, meaning that I have never, Ya Rab, asked you for a need and you let me down. This is the way we should turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you see, when he invoked Allah in such manner, Allah answered his dua and gave him his wish. So you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the certainty that Allah is going to answer you. And if he doesn't answer, then it's for our own benefit. As we read in dua al-iftitah, فَلَعَلَّ الَّذِي أَخَّرَ عَلَيَّ هُوَ خَيْرٌ لِي لِعِلْكَ بِعَاقِبَةِ الْأُمُورِ. Maybe what delayed the answer to my dua, my prayer, is what's in a benefit for me, because you know the consequences. I may ask for something, I think it is good for me because I don't see the big picture. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows the big picture. I don't know the future. So I think this is good for me. So I say, Ya Rabbi, give it to me. Ya Rabbi, give it to me. And it doesn't happen. I feel bad. I say, Allah didn't answer me. Allah doesn't accept my du'as. Maybe a few years later, maybe in the akhirah, I will realize that it was for my own benefit that this du'a was not accepted. And Allah may have had a better plan for me. So this is the way we should approach dua, my brothers and sisters. with certainty, yaqeen, that Allah answers it for us. And if He doesn't answer it for us, then it is for our own benefit. And He will answer the dua, maybe not in dunya, but in the akhirah. As there is a hadith that says, on the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call upon some mu'mineen and tell them that you asked me for a dua in the dunya, but I answered it for you, but delayed the answer to the akhirah, to the day of judgment, to the hereafter. So now I'm going to answer your dua, and He will shower the individual with His blessings and givings and so on and so forth, to the point where the person would say, Ya Rab, my Lord, I wish you had never accepted or answered any of my duas. But of course, the human being is weak, is not capable. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers most of our duas. And if there are some that He delays the answer for, it is for our own benefit. So therefore, dua is extremely important. That's one. Second, we come to the next point. Al-Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam and dua. Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam were always engaged in dua constantly. We have a hadith that says, Kana Amirul Mu'mineen alayhi salam da'an. Da'an means constantly praying for dua. And indeed, if you take a look at some of the books of du'as in the Shi'i school of thought, you will find, subhanAllah, there is a dua before sleep, dua after you wake up, dua before you take a shower, dua when you take the wudu, dua when you wear your clothes, dua when you leave the house, dua for everything in the school of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. So they were always engaged in dua with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi, no exception. He constantly engaged in dua with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, on the day of Ashura, the last day in his life, when he knows that he is going to be martyred and he is going to go to Jannah, one of the enemies on the day of Ashura told him, because Imam al-Husayn alayhi salam lit fire around his camp and he stayed in the front of the camp, so this way people cannot attack from behind. So he dug a trench and he lit it up with fire so that people can only come from one side. The enemies would face him on one end. So one of the enemies told him, Ya Hussein, Asta'ajalta bin-nar? Did you rush? You lit up fire in dunya before waiting for the fire of the akhirah? يعني والعياذ بالله. He's telling Imam al-Hussein that you're going to be killed and going to go to the fire. والعياذ بالله. Al-Imam al-Hussein salamullahi alayhi immediately answered him. And he said to him, Kadhibta, you're lying. Rather, al-Jannatu wallah, I'm going to Jannah. So Imam al-Hussein salamullahi alayhi knows he's going to Jannah, knows what is awaiting for him on his last day. Yet, he does not stop from the dua. He starts his day with dua after praying Salatul Fajr. If you read the books of Maqtal, that talk about the martyrdom of Imam al-Hussein on the day of Ashura, and I have recently translated, alhamdulillah, the Maqtal, inshallah, soon if Allah gives us tawfiq, we should be publishing it. But you will be reading that he prayed Salatul Fajr with his companions, and then immediately he turned to Allah. Allahumma anta thiqati fi kulli karb, wa raja'i fi kulli shiddah. وأنت ثقتي في كل عدة وأنت ثقتي وأنت لي في كل أمر نزل بي ثقة وعدة كم من هم يضعف فيه الفؤاد وتقل فيه الحيلة. To the end of that beautiful dua, short dua. It's recommended you read this dua when you are facing difficulties. اللهم أنت ثقتي في كل كرب. Oh Allah, you are my trust in every calamity. ورجائي في كل شدة, and my hope in every difficulty. So, and that to the end of the dua. This is how he started his morning. And then minutes before his martyrdom, salamullahi alayhi, when he collapsed on the plains of Karbala after being heavily wounded, salamullahi alayhi, he made a pillow of the sand and he put his holy cheek on the sand. And he lied down there and he said, Allahumma anta muta'ali al-makan, azim al-jabarut. Oh Allah, you're the exalted in your status. You're the powerful in your actions. A beautiful dua that has great meaning of tawheed in his final moment. So he began the day of Ashura with the dua and the need for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he ended his life with the call of dua and asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for help and support. So Al-Imam Al-Hussein salamullahi alayhi was always engaged in dua. And this takes us to the dua of the day of Arafah. The hadith says, on the day of Arafah, he walked out of his tent after Salatul Dhuhr. And the people who were with him, they all surrounded him. And he stood by a mountain in the desert of Arafat, known as the mountain of Rahmah, Jabal Rahmah. He stood by. It is makruh for the followers of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam to go on the mountain of Rahmah after sunrise of the day of Arafah. So he did not go on the mountain. He stood by the mountain. And then he raised his hands high up such that people could see the armpits, you know, the whiteness. Basically, his clothes is like this. He went like this almost. You can see with the limited camera here. And he raised, just like a beggar, you know, someone who's begging, you know, he raised his hands like this with his head up in the heat of the sun, and he read Dua Arafah. Now imagine, people who were around him, they started crying and crying and crying upon listening to these beautiful words of the Dua Arafah. Indeed, we are lucky in the school of Ahlul Bayt to have Ahlul Bayt teaching us all these beautiful and wonderful du'as. Now, in this du'a Arafah, we will discuss, inshallah, 5 points, if Allah gives us tawfiq. The first point is the irfan. And what I mean by irfan, the recognition of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the words of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi in Nahjul Balagha, in the first sermon, he says, أَوَّلُ الدِّينِ مَعْرِفَتُهُ وَكَمَالُ مَعْرِفَتِهِ التَّصْدِيقُ بِهِ وَكَمَالُ التَّصْدِيقُ بِهِ تَوْحِيدُهُ. The essence of the religion, أَوَّلُ الدِّينِ, أَوَّل here could be the first thing in the religion, يعني the first step towards the spiritual ascension towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is to recognize him, to recognize la ilaha illallah. Or the awwal here may not mean first, it could mean the essence, يعني the pinnacle, the essence of the religion is to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Arafa is different from alima. Alima is to know. Arafa is to recognize. And it's a three-letter word, the root word. Ayn, ra-fa, arafa, arafa. Not to be confused with the sahra of Arafat, or the day of Arafah, which has a ta marbuta or ha at the end. And there is a hadith that says it is called the day of Arafah because that's the day when you would recognize the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and when you would confess and do i'tiraf of your sins before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Allah would forgive your sins, inshallah. That's one tradition or one saying as to why it's called Arafah. So Arafah is to recognize. Recognize meaning that you know deeper. For example, you might know somebody, but if you see him, you don't recognize him. So you know him. And that's why sometimes when you meet somebody, it may have happened to you guys, where one day you met somebody and you shake his hand, salamun alaykum, alaykum as-salam. Then they tell you this is so and so. And you're like, oh, you're Fulan, you're so. If they had told you prior to seeing this person, you know so and so, and you would say, yes, I know him very well. I know the name. But what you did not recognize him. Now, when you saw him and they told you this is so, and so you knew, you had the knowledge, you had the ilm, you did not have the ma'rifah. Now your knowledge has deepened. So it's a deeper state of knowledge, ma'rifah or arafah, to recognize. Now you recognize the person. Now you have that, developed that recognition. So that developed after having a deeper knowledge of the individual. That's what arafah is, and hence the word irfan, which basically means ma'rifatullah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to recognize Allah. And Allah cannot be recognized but through the Quran and Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, as we read in the dua in Mafatihul Jinan. It's called dua zamanul ghaiba. Allahumma arrifni nafsaka fa innaka in lam tu'arrifni nafsak lam a'rif nabiyyak. Allahumma arrifni nabiyyak fa innaka in lam tu'arrifni nabiyyak lam a'rif hujjatak. Allahumma arrifni hujjatak fa innaka in lam tu'arrifni hujjatak dhalaltu 'an dini. Oh Allah, make me recognize you, for if I don't recognize you, I would not be able to recognize your prophet. Oh Allah, make me recognize your prophet. For if I don't recognize your prophet, I would not recognize your hujjah, your proof. Oh Allah, make me recognize your proof. For if I do not recognize your proof, I would be misguided from my religion. First, I have to believe in Allah, recognize that Allah exists. Allah created me. And that's something that we can achieve through the intellect. When we see, for example, and there are numerous hadiths from Ahlul Bayt alayhi wasalam, and numerous proofs that they used and strategies. Amongst them is what they call Dalilul Burhan, or Dalilul Nazm, Burhanul Nazm, sorry, Burhanul Nazm. Burhanul Nazm, meaning that you look at this world, look how wonderful it is, how great it is. And the intellect tells us whenever we see something that is well organized, there has to be a designer, there has to be a maker. Yani you don't see a car and someone tells you this car just made itself by itself, by coincidence. Your aql, your intellect, your reason would not accept that answer. There has to be someone who designed it, someone who made it, someone who spent time on it. Then you would accept that. But for the car to make itself by itself, your aql, your reason would not accept this. Similarly, that's a car. Imagine this whole world, the sun, the moon, the stars, the distance, the gravity, the human being, the kingdoms, animal kingdom, the kingdom of the animals, the different kingdoms, the plant kingdom, and so on and so forth. And when you look at this whole universe, you come to the conclusion there has to be a God. So you'll recognize Allah. Once you recognize that there is a God, then you would think that, okay, what does this God want of me? So then his messengers come, his prophets come, and they will start guiding you. And when you see the miracles of these prophets, when you take a look at their actions, their deeds, you believe in them, that indeed they are messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So then I listen to them. And through them, I recognize, for example, what Allah wants of me. And through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, we recognize, for example, the imamah. Through Ali ibn Abi Talib sallallahu alayhi and his descendants alayhim as-salam. So that's called ma'rifah. Now we recognize. And that's why, by brothers and sisters, Allah is not referred to as arif. He's referred to as alim. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his ilm is always clear, is always deep, is always in completion, such that he never forgets, wal'iyadu billah, he never, no ignorance is contaminating his knowledge. I may have some knowledge, but maybe some ignorance be there, like the example of that individual whom I know his name, I know the individual, but I've never met him, so I didn't recognize him. So there was a component of ignorance here. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't have that component. So in Dua Arafah, we find that Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi is trying to help us understand the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And one of the ways to recognize Allah, one of them, is through recognizing yourself, how you are limited and how He is great. So for example, in Dua Arafah, Imam Hussein alayhi salam has a portion, has a section in the dua where he says, وَإِنْ أَعُدَّ نِعَمَكَ وَمِنَنَكَ وَكَرَائِمَ مِنَحِكَ لَا أُحْصِيهَا يَا مَوْلَاي. If I count your blessings and your bounties and what you have given me, I am unable to count them. This is derived from the Quran. And this is a point that, unfortunately, there was no time to discuss it today in the discussion. And that's about the incorporation of ayat or meaning derived from the ayat in the du'as of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, and how beautifully amalgamated they are. So that is something that is maybe to be discussed at a later time, inshallah. But here, the Imam is saying, if I try to count your bounties, I won't be able to do so. And like I said, there is an ayah in the Quran that says, if you count or try to count the blessings of Allah, you won't be able to do so. Indeed. In fact, in another sentence, not in this section, in a prior section to this section, Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi says, your bounties are not countable. We cannot count them. Like, we are unable to count your bounties. And how can I count your bounties when, in fact, the harm that you have kept away from me is greater than the blessings you have bestowed upon me? Yani today, for example, how many viruses are there in the world? I mean, just now we're experiencing this whole pandemic. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep it away from humanity at large and make those who are ill with it and all illnesses to grant them a quick recovery. But how many different kinds of illnesses there are in the world today? If you really try to think about them, subhanAllah, you know, there are maybe thousands of illnesses people don't even think about, from diabetes to cancer to the different kinds of bacterial infections to the different kind of viral infections to, subhanAllah, all these different kinds of diseases, illnesses, harm, in addition to other forms of harm. For example, God forbid, a tree falling on someone, lightning striking somebody. Like, all this is harm that a person can be harmed with. Allah keeps all these kinds of harms away from humanity, from most of us, alhamdulillah. So these are blessings of Allah that we don't even recognize. If Allah showers me with all these kinds of blessings, how dare I disobey Him? Think about it, brothers and sisters. If you experience a problem, an illness that may cause you to die, wal'iyadu billah, someone comes and, for example, donates a kidney to you, for example. Because of that kidney that was donated to you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you health and you were able to survive and live. How much indebted would you be to the person who gave you his kidney? You might tell that person, Jazakallahu khayra, you were the reason, Allah made you the reason to keep me alive. I would have died. But alhamdulillah, because of your kidney, Allah made it a reason that I am still alive. If this person who donated a kidney to you one day came and asked you for something, would you dare to tell him no? If he asked you for some help when you are capable of doing that, would you say no? And if you do, what would people say about you? Say, this person who donated his kidney to you, he helped you. He's now asking you to do something for him, which is within your means, within your ability, and you are refusing? Now, this is a person who gave us a kidney, one kidney. What about the person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who gave us life? He gave us everything. Would I dare to disobey him? If we can come to that recognition, to that kind of understanding, to that level, we would never disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We would be embarrassed. We would be ashamed of disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not because we're afraid of his punishments. Not because we're seeking his paradise and reward. But rather because he is worthy of being worshipped. Can a person achieve that kind of level? Yes. We have in Kitab al-Kafi, al-Sharif, a hadith, a prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, I will briefly mention the hadith. The hadith is long, but very briefly, the prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, enters the masjid one day to pray Fajr. After praying Fajr, he finds a youth, a young man. His face is pale, yellow. Prophet tells him, what's the matter with you? Are you okay? And the youth says, Ya Rasulallah, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what has caused me to be in this state. I love Allah. And then the Prophet asked him, the love of Allah has signs. What are your signs? So he started describing his signs. This is in Kitab al-Kafi, al-Sharif. Upon describing the signs, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi said to him, young man, you are truthful in what you claim. Stay the way you are. Yani, continue on this. If you've reached that level of love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Ya Rasulallah, pray for me that I get shahada. I want to die as a shaheed with you, Ya Rasulallah. The Prophet prayed for him. And in one of the battles, he was the 10th person to be martyred. After 9 people, he was the 10th to be martyred. Radwanullahi ta'ala alayh. So people can attain that level. This level is not only exclusive for the ma'sumin alayhim as-salam, but it requires that kind of understanding how great Allah is. Then, after mentioning this, he continues. He says, how great Allah is. Ya Mawlai, O my master, antal ladhi manant, you are the one who favored. Antal ladhi an'amt, you're the one who gave bounties, who blessed. Antal ladhi ahsant, you're the one who provided me with kindness. Antal ladhi ajmalt, antal ladhi afdalt, antal ladhi, and so on and so forth. Anta. Again, we don't have time to go over every word in here, but you can take a look at this. And then after saying, this is how great you are, Ya Allah, he comes to himself. And of course, when he says ana, he says, thumma ana ya ilahi al-mu'tarifu bi dhunubi faghfirha li. Oh Allah, I am the one who is confessing of my sins, so forgive them for me. Here, Imam al-Husayn is ma'soom. So why is he saying my sins? Allama al-Majlisi in Bihar al-Anwar has several reasons for this. I will mention only two of them for the sake of time. One, Ahlul Bayti alayhim as-salam have that kind of level of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that when they do the human things that they have to do as humans, they feel that they are at shortcomings. For example, every human being has to sleep. Allahu la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum la ta'khudhuhu sinatun wa la nawm. Allah doesn't sleep, doesn't snooze. As human beings, even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi needed some time to sleep, even if it is few minutes in the day, but he needed to rest. Ahlul Bayti alayhim as-salam needed time to rest. They have to eat. They need to eat. They need to drink, for example, water to stay alive. So they're human beings. They feel, although their sleep is ibadah, because their sleep is to gain the strength to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Their food, eating, is to gain the strength to worship. So even that's ibadah. But they feel that because they're doing these human actions, that they are at shortcomings. You know, meaning that because they recognize the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no matter how much they do, they feel that still I haven't done much. I haven't done enough. Again, going back to the point, the example of that person who gives you a kidney, maybe sometimes you start giving so much to this person and you still feel that, you know, I still feel I haven't done much for this person. Okay. So that kind, that's why they do istighfar, like, ya Allah, forgive me. It's not because they have committed a sin, but rather they feel that no matter how much they do, still not enough. So ya Allah, forgive us for our shortcomings. That's one. Second, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, Ali and I are the fathers of this nation. And just like any father, sometimes you have a son, you might have a son who, let's say, takes a rock and breaks the window of, you go to the neighbor's house, you knock the door and you apologize. Say, I am very sorry, my son broke the window. Please forgive us. And let me know what the cost is, I'll fix it for you, for example. Why are you apologizing? You did not do anything wrong. Why are you asking for forgiveness? You did not do anything wrong. But because your son is of you, so his actions count on you. And therefore, whatever mistakes he makes, you seek forgiveness for these mistakes. And you apologize for these mistakes. Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam are like the fathers to us. So whenever we disobey, they pray to Allah to forgive us. They apologize on our behalf. So here Imam al-Hussein alayhi salam saying, Ya Ilahi, ana thumma ya ana ya Ilahi, then I am. So this is you, anta, 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 you, then comes, then I am, O my Lord, O my God, al-mu'tarifu bi-dhunubi, the one who's confessing my sins. Faghfirha li, so forgive my sins for me. Ana alladhi asa'at, I am the one who made mistakes. Ana alladhi akhta'at, I am the one who sinned. Ana alladhi hamamt, yani I hamamt, I mean I intended to commit the ma'asiyah, wal'iyadu billah. Ana alladhi jahilt, I am the ignorant, and so on and so forth. Ana. So you see, I know my limitation. I know how weak I am. And my limitations make me realize how great he is, how wonderful he is. So how do I dare to disobey him after all this? We should try to aim at that kind of ibadah. Brothers and sisters, it's not just that we read the dua and khalas, that's it. Try to live the meaning of the dua. Try to live. Read it. Reading dua is very important. It is very important to read these duas. The day of Arafah is coming, inshallah, on Thursday. Try to read the dua. Try to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the same time, ask Allah to give you the tawfiq to live the meaning of the dua. So don't ever hurt anybody. Pray to Allah to take arrogance away from us, to take any animosity away from us, from our hearts, towards our fellow mu'mineen and mu'minat. Any problems that we might have, let's pray to Allah to forgive us, to cure these problems, whether it is ghiba, backbiting, jealousy, any kind of problems and faults that we might have. So that's the irfan part. And we'll stop here for this irfan part. This takes me to the next point, which is the hikmah. Wisdom, in some of the philosophers' point of view. Some Muslim philosophers like Ibn Sina, Mullah Sadra, they say the human being has two states. The state of the clay, marhalat turabiyya, because we're created from clay, which means the materialistic state. And then there is the spiritual state, al-marhala ruhiyya, or rutba ruhiyya. They say if the human being does actions for the sake of his materialistic state, then he is always going to be confined to the materialistic world. For example, a person says, I want to study. Well, why do you want to study? So that I can get a degree. Why do you want to get a degree? So that I can graduate. Why do you want to graduate? So that I can have a good job. Well, what do you want to do with a good job? So I have a good income. What do you want to do with this income? So that I can live a comfortable life, buy a nice house, buy a nice car, live a luxurious life. It's all I. If, however, This person says, I want to study because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi says, طلب العلم فريضة. Seeking knowledge is mandatory upon every Muslim and Muslimah. I want to study because I want to be alim. Alim, not in the sense like alim deen, alim of religion. Alim is a scholar, someone with knowledge, whether a lawyer, engineer, journalist. I want to have knowledge. So I want to have some understanding. I want to understand my religion. I want to understand the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I want to invest time on fiqh. You don't have to be a faqih and a hawza student to learn fiqh. So you can learn all these things. I want, now I'm not thinking about studying and things only from the materialistic, rather about way of serving the spiritual proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, getting that spiritual proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I want to earn income so I can serve the community. So that is the next level. Okay. In this dua, Al-Imam Al-Hussein salamullah alayhi wants to take that human being from just I to you, Ya Allah. I want to be able to serve, grow in my spirituality. So in many parts of the dua, we read, for example, the Imam says, La ilaha illa ant, subhanaka inni kuntu min al-zalimin. La ilaha illa ant, subhanaka inni kuntu min al-mustaghfirin. Again, always thinking, La ilaha illa Allah, La ilaha illa ant, La ilaha illa ant. And then doing the tasbih of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma, hadha thana'i alayka mumajjidan wa ikhlasi li dhikrika muwahhidan wa iqrari bi ala'ika mu'addidan. Here I am confessing of your greatness, of your tawheed. I am confessing of your blessings upon me. And then, وَتَقَادُمِهَا إِلَى حَادِثٍ مَا لَمْ تَزَلْ تَتَعَهَّدُنِي بِهِ مَعَهَا مُنْذُ خَلَقْتَنِي وَبَرَأْتَنِي مِنْ أَوَّلِ الْعُمْرِ مِنَ الْإِغْنَاءِ مِنَ الْفَقْرِ وَكَشْفِ الضُّرِّ. يعني يا الله, you're the one who made me not live in poverty. يعني the rizq comes from, and you kept all harm away from me, ya Allah. So once I recognize all this, then I would turn to you, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I would try to confess to you, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and so on and so forth. Okay, so that's something that is important when it comes to hikmah, wisdom. Allah says, يُؤْتِي الْحِكْمَةَ مَنْ يَشَاءُ. Allah grants wisdom to whomever He wills. In the sense, in the context that, Ya Allah, elevate my status before you, so that I would not always think about me. Rather, when I think about myself, I think of me as a servant of you. And in a society, how can I contribute to my society, to my community? How can I serve? Because everything I have comes from you, Ya Allah. Which is, again, going back to the point of Irfan, recognizing yourself, your limitations. And that is, in a way, recognizing how great Allah is. So you're now ascending in that spiritual ladder of ascension. That's the second point, the hikmah, the wisdom, and the points of, from the perspective of some Muslim philosophers. Third point that we will discuss, inshallah, in the dua here is the khudu', how Imam al-Hussein submits to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has the khushu', the understanding, the realization when he turns to Allah and he raises his hands like a beggar and he cries and everyone around him is crying. Allah says, قَدْ أَفْلَحَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ هُمْ فِي صَلَاتِهِمْ خَاشِعُونَ. Indeed, successful are the believers or the faithful ones who in their salat, they submit to Allah. They have their mind in their salat. So the submission, meaning that when we do actions, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, الذي خلق الموت والحياة ليبلوكم أيكم أحسن عملا. The one who created death and life to test you. So we're being tested in this world. With what? Which one of you has the best of deeds? أحسن عملا. Not the most of deeds. Some people say, I go to Hajj every year, except this year, unfortunately, because of the pandemic. I go to Ziyarah every year. I donate this much. I give that much. You go to the centers, you find the names, plaques, this, the family of so-and-so, the family of so-and-so. I give this, I give this, I give this. I've come across a person who told a group of people, because he donates to them, he says, you need me. You need me. Subhanallah. If that's your attitude, then your actions may not be sincerely and purely be qurbatan ila Allah ta'ala here. So who are you trying to fool here? Make sure your actions are qurbatan ila Allah ta'ala. Ahsanu amala, not the most aktharukum amala, with the one of you with most actions, but rather the best action, meaning the best niyyah. You do actions, but qurbatan ila Allah ta'ala. How many of those do you have? How many salat have you prayed purely for the sake of Allah? How many ziyarah did you perform purely for the sake of Allah, where nobody knew about it? How many times you served, you donated, you gave without anyone knowing anything about it other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? These are the actions that are the best of the deeds. Whether people recognize me or they don't, that's not going to change the way I deal with people. And that's something that would add to humility. Humbleness, tawadhu. Okay, so that's the next point. The fourth point in Dua Arafah that we will mention, inshallah, is the tawassul. And what I mean by the tawassul is seeking intercession from Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam in Dua Arafah. First of all, who taught us Dua Arafah? Al-Imam al-Hussein salamullah alayhi. Without Al-Imam al-Hussein salamullah alayhi, would we have been able to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Without Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhim as-salam, Ahlul Bayt, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, and the beautiful du'as and the teachings of Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam, would we have been able to recognize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? No. So our means of recognizing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Dua Kumail, who taught us Dua Kumail other than Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullahi alayhi? Who could have taught us Dua Kumail besides Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, of course? So the teachings about recognition of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, about Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, about Allah comes from Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Therefore, our means of recognizing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, are Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. That's one. Second, many times Ahlul Bayt would ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through Ahlul Bayt in Nahjul Balagha. Amir al-Mu'mineen salamullah alayhi says in the short words of wisdom in Nahjul Balagha number 351, in the copy that I have, which is the copy, is the print from the holy shrine of Imam Ali alayhi salam in 2015, that's when they printed this copy. In short words of wisdom 351, Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salam says in Nahjul Balagha, إذا كانت لك إلى الله سبحانه حاجة فابدأ بمسألة الصلاة على النبي صلى الله عليه وآله ثم سل حاجتك فإن الله أكرم من أن يسأل حاجتين فيقضي إحداهما ويمنع الأخرى. If you have a need before Allah Almighty, the Exalted, so begin your need by as-salat ala Muhammad ala an-nabi sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. I say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, then ask your haja. Why? He gives the reason. For indeed Allah is more generous, more honorable to accept when you are presented to be asked two needs, and he accepts one and rejects the other one. Because when you say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, that's a dua saying, oh Allah, bless Muhammad and his family. And that dua will definitely be answered, because Allah will definitely bless Muhammad and his family. And then ask for your haja. So when you say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, and then you say Ya Rabbi, help me, isn't that tawassul? In Dua Arafat, there are six examples where Imam al-Husayn salamullahi alayhi says Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. He says salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa a'inni ala bawa'iq ad-duhur. Then another one, he says Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa atmim alayna ni'amak wa as'idna bi ta'atik. Then number three, salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad wa a'tini fi hadhihi al-'ashiyya afdala ma a'tayt. Give me on this evening, on this eve, the best what you have given. Then number five, Allahumma fasalli ala Muhammadin abdika wa rasulika wa nabiyika wa ala alihi at-tayyibin at-tahirin ajma'in wa tammim lana ni'amak. And complete and fulfill your blessings upon us. Allahumma, number six, فَصَلِّ عَلَى مُحَمَّدٍ وَآلِ مُحَمَّدٍ كَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ أَهْلٌ لِذَلِكَ مِنْكَ يَا عَظِيمٌ فَصَلِّ عَلَيْهِ وَعَلَى آلِهِ الْمُنْتَجَبِينَ الطَّيِّبِينَ الطَّاهِرِينَ أَجْمَعِينَ وَتَغَمَّدْنَا بِعَفْوِكَ. See how many times? Six times in the dua, Imam al-Husayn says, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. So he's doing tawassul. He's doing dhikr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala by remembering, by mentioning Ahlul Bayt. So the dua would be accepted and answered. Because some people say one should not do tawassul through Ahlul Bayt alayhim as-salam. Go straight to Allah. You can. You definitely can. In fact, Ayatollah Sistani, may Allah prolong his life inshallah, was asked. He said, is it possible for a muwali, meaning someone who recognizes the right of Ahlul Bayt, yeah, someone who believes in the imamah, that he would seek the dua straight to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without mentioning any wasila, any intercession, with his conviction that the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who gives the ibad and he is the one who sustains them? So the answer is, of course, that's permissible. Yajuz dhalik. So definitely you can go straight to Allah. So there's nothing wrong. We're not saying that you cannot go straight to Allah. Okay. You can. However, ala inna iqtirana ad-du'a bit-tawassul. However, he says, so it's permissible to go straight to Allah without asking wasila, without talking to, without saying, oh Allah, through by Muhammad wa ali Muhammad, grant me this. However, he says, illa anna iqtirana ad-du'a bit-tawassul bin-nabiy sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa ahli baytihi alayhim assalam mimma yuqarribu ijabatah. When you do dua through tawassul through the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi and his holy family, that would fasten, hasten the answer and the acceptance of the dua. Kama warad al-hath lil-mudhnib, as the encouragement came for the sinner to go to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alihi wasallam and ask him to do istighfar for him, as per the ayah in Surah An-Nisa, walau annahum idh-dhalamu anfusahum, when they oppress themselves, they come to you, so they seek forgiveness from Allah, and the Prophet or the Messenger seeks forgiveness for them, they would find Allah all forgiving, all merciful. وَلَيْسَ ذَلِكَ عَنْ حَاجَةٍ لَهُ سُبْحَانَهُ إِلَىٰ تَقْدِيمِ الْوَسَّئِلَةِ تَعَالَىٰ عَنْ ذَلِكَ. And that's not because he needs, Allah doesn't, you can go straight to Allah, it's not that Allah needs the wasila. However, that is his wisdom, ولكنه مما اقتضته حكمته البالغة تقديرا منه لعباده الصالحين. This is what his high wisdom, بالغة, his complete wisdom, Allah dictated, and that's what he has ordained upon his virtuous servants. In the book الصحيح من سيرة النبي الأعظم صلى الله عليه وآله by Sayyid Ja'far Murtada al-Amili رضوان الله تعالى عليه, who passed away just recently, in volume 1, he narrates a hadith from Ibn Mas'ud. Ibn Mas'ud entered to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. It's a long hadith. I will just mention this portion of the hadith. And he told him, Ya Rasulullah, teach me religion the way I should understand it. So the Prophet told him, go into this room. He went into this room and he saw Imam Ali alayhi salam doing sujood and saying, Allahumma بحق نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وآله إلا غفرت للمذنبين من شيعتي Oh Allah, I ask you by your the right of your Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi, that you forgive the sinners of my Shia. Ibn Mas'ud says, I came out of the room, I saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa alayhi in salat doing sujood and saying, Allahumma bihaq aliyin waliyika illa ma ghafarta lilmuznibina min ummati. I ask you by the right of Ali, Wali, Waliullah, that you would forgive the sinners of my ummah. So what Sayyid Ja'far, so the Prophet is doing tawassul through Ali ibn Abi Talib, alayhi salam. And Ali ibn Abi Talib, Amir al-Mu'mineen, is doing tawassul through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. In the salat, praying for the Shia, praying for the Mu'mineen. And Sayyid Ja'far Murtada al-Amili, رضوان الله تعالى, concludes, he says, and this demonstrates the permissibility of doing tawassul to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with whomever Allah loves. And Allah indeed loves Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad salawatullahi wa salam alayhi wa ajma'in. So therefore, we can definitely ask and do tawassul as Imam al-Hussein 6 times in this dua, idas tawassul. The last point I want to touch upon in this dua, there is a section in this dua which may be a foreshadowing for Karbala. What do we mean? He says, oh Allah, ashhadu ya ilahi bihaqiqati imani. Ya Allah, I am bearing witness with the truthful confession of my iman, faith. And then he starts saying that not only me, every basically limb and organ of my body does so. For example, he mentions, wa khurqi masaribi nafsi, even the openings of my nose confess of my faith in you. Even, I'm not going to go through every one of those because it's lengthy, but I'll mention some of them. He mentions, for example, my chest. He mentions my mouth and my chin, my teeth. He mentions my ears. He mentions, for example, my liver. He mentions the liver. He mentions my chest, my chest. He says my heart, and so on and so forth. My ribs, they all confess. My bones, they all confess of the Tawheed. And what happened on the day of Ashura to the chest of Al-Imam Al-Hussein Salamullahi Alayhi? He may have been foreshadowing, mentioning all these specific limbs and organs of the Imam. What happened to the liver of the Imam Salamullahi Alayhi on the day of Ashura when it was shot with a head, with an arrow that was three, that had three heads? What happened to the head of Al-Imam Al-Hussein? What happened to the bones of Al-Imam Al-Hussein under the horses of Bani Umayyah? Yani the Imam Salamullahi Alayhi, maybe suggesting to the people, look at all these limbs. My limbs all testify and confess in their submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And yet these limbs are going to be crushed under the horses of Bani Umayyah and the spears of Bani Umayyah and the arrows of Bani Umayyah and the swords of Bani Umayyah. So here, it could be some foreshadowing about Karbala. And indeed, brothers and sisters, when you have this beautiful dua coming from Al-Imam Al-Hussein, Salamullahi Alayhi, indeed it has a huge impact on people. Because he is a man who has designated his whole life for the sake of Allah, sacrificed his life and the life of his family and children for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we hear this dua coming from him, indeed it has a huge impact. So next time when you read dua Arafah, just remember inshallah that I am trying to get closer to Allah through Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. I need to carry the values, the teachings, the akhlaq of Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to change me to become a person whom He is pleased with and Ahlul Bayt are pleased with, such that I can qualify to become among the companions of the Imam salamullah alayhi. And then you need to put in the effort to change and the determination to change. This dua is really beautiful. If you have friends, share it with them. I will finish my discussion with this story. A few years ago, we were in Arafah, on the day of Arafah, and after Salatul Dhuhr, we wanted to start the dua of Arafah, of Al-Imam al-Hussein salamullahi alayhi. We had a stranger walk into our tent. He sat down, and I was reading dua Arafah. He was crying and crying and crying. When we finished the dua, he got up and he wanted to leave. I was reciting, so I couldn't catch up to him, but I informed some of the mu'mineen. I told them, go see how can be of service to this individual. We have a guest. We should not just let him walk in and out without being served with something. So the mu'mineen went to him. They inquired. He said, I am a Sunni, not a Shi'i. Few years ago, I was in Hajj. There was a Shi'i tent on the day of Arafah next to our tent. On the day of Arafah, we sit down, maybe we pray, we rest, we're just waiting for the day to finish. As we were sitting down, I heard from the next tent, the Shi'i tent, people reading a beautiful dua. I started listening to that dua. The words were moving, moving. I got up, went into their tent. I asked, what is this dua that you guys just recited? It is moving. They told me, we are Shia. And this dua is taught to us by Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam. It is known as the dua of Al-Imam Al-Hussein alayhi salam on the day of Arafah. I asked them, when do you people usually recite this dua? They said, on the day of Arafah, after Salatul Dhuhr. He said, so I kept it in mind. Every year I come to Hajj. After Salatul Dhuhr, I would go roaming around, trying to find a tent of Shia, any tent, anybody. Because I know they would be reading that beautiful dua of Al-Imam Al-Hussein, salamullahi alayhi, on the day of Arafah. And I don't want to miss it. So I attend, I read, I cry, and I remember Al-Imam al-Hussein, salamullahi alayhi. So you see, brothers and sisters, the beauty of this dua, which attracts the heart of the mu'mineen. Why? Because it comes from a man who's in the pinnacle of his faith, in the pinnacle of his certainty and yaqeen. A man who sacrificed everything for the sake of Allah. And he says, oh my Lord, if this pleases you, then take even more from me until you are fully pleased. Take. Well, you have such a great personality. Indeed, the dua would penetrate the heart. As some of the ulama say, what comes from the heart enters people's heart. You might hear a lot of people giving talks and discussions. When someone is truly talking from his heart, you can tell, because it pierces the heart. And when you have Al-Imam Al-Hussein, salamullah alayhi, giving this beautiful dua, then Allah, Allah, we should really read it, reflect upon it, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase our hidayah and guidance. May Allah bless you, ya mu'mineen wa ya mu'minat. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Before I finish, for the arwah of all marhumin and marhuminat, mu'mineen and mu'minat, especially the organizers, you, mu'mineen and mu'minat, your marhumin, and to hasten the reappearance of our Imam al-Mahdi al-Muntadhar, ajalallah ta'ala, farajahu al-Sharif, let's recite Surah al-Mubarakat al-Fatiha with salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Ar-Rahmanir rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم الصراط الذين انعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين سبق الله عليهم احسنتم. Yes, my brothers and sisters.
Sheikh, thank you so much for that address. It was very good, very, very informative. I'm hoping personally I can keep that frame of mind in mind on Thursday, and appreciate the words of wisdom. Everyone, if you do have questions, just a reminder, you can enter them into the Mentee. I think the code is showing on the screen. Feel free to go ahead and enter your questions. Sheikh, we already have some questions in the queue.
Yes.
Some questions may have come a little bit earlier and you may have touched upon them, but I'll ask them anyways in case you want to elaborate or in case anybody may have come a little bit late. First question is, dua is a form of and is strongly connected to ibadat. Then is calling upon the aima for help and doing dua to them to alleviate problems acceptable?
As I mentioned in my address, it is acceptable for as long as we know that their ability to alleviate difficulties comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions about Prophet Isa alayhi salam. He himself says, as per the Quran, and I cure the blind and the one with leprosy, I cure. So people used to go to Isa alayhi salam and say to him, Ya Ruhallah, O Messenger of Allah, can you cure my son, for example? And he would wipe with his holy hand over the eyes of the child, and the person would start seeing again. Or if someone has leprosy, he would wipe with his holy hand over the person and the illness would disappear. So if someone goes to Isa alayhi salam and tells him, O Messenger of Allah, can you cure my son? Is this shirk? The answer is no. Why not? Well, because Allah has given him this ability. So definitely I can go to Isa salamullahi alayhi and say, Ya Ruhallah, cure my son. Therefore, we can go to Ahlul Bayt alayhim salam. And we have a hadith that their sanctity, whether dead or alive, is the same. Yani, Ahlul Bayt hear us when we invoke, when we call them, when we ask them. In the Salat, we say, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh. Would you say salam upon someone who's dead? So when you say, As-salamu alayka ayyuhan nabiyyu wa rahmatullah wa barakatuh, he, inshallah, is responding, answering your salam. So I can say, Ya Rasulullah, help me. Ya Rasulullah, protect me. For I know that ability for help and protection comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah gave him that ability. And therefore, there is no harm in going straight to the ma'sumeen alayhim assalam and asking from them. As I mentioned, Ayatullah Sistani, may Allah prolong his life, mentions that while you can go straight to Allah, but going through the ma'soom, the wasila of the ma'soom, would facilitate the acceptance and the answer of your dua. Sayyid Ja'far Murtada al-Amili says that if you ask Allah through the creation whom he loves, then there is no harm in this. It's fine, it's permissible, and you can do it. And we know Allah loves Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi majma'in. So we can turn to them. Yes.
JazakAllah khair. Another question is, can you give us some advice and recommendations on what you would suggest as good amals to be done on the day of Arafat? And secondly, what would you say is the best time to recite the dua of Imam Hussein on the day of Arafat?
It's mustahab to recite the dua under the clear skies after dhuhr salat. So when you pray salat of dhuhr, afterwards, you can recite the dua. That's when it's mustahab. It's mustahab to fast on the day of Arafah if you are able to fast. Just a reminder, the mu'mineen have qada fast. They cannot fast mustahab. When you have qada fast, you have to fast the qada. But maybe out of Allah's rahmah, if you fast on the day of Arafah, qada'an, like you say, I'm fasting qada on the day of Arafah, Allah out of his rahmah may give you, inshallah, double rewards. Because you're fasting on the day of Arafah as well. So I'll give you the reward for doing your qada and the reward, inshallah, for fasting on the day of Arafah. Allah is Rahim, Kareem. Reading dua Imam al-Hussein is important. One important aspect, my brothers and sisters, you're asking me what are good deeds and actions to be done. So definitely read dua, do fasting, read dua after dhuhr if you have the time and the ability to do so. But one thing keep in mind, we are seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So for example, on the day of Arafah and the next day, which is going to be the day of Eid, on these couple of days, try to avoid committing a sin. On these couple of days, do not backbite. And if you do, immediately do istighfar. On that day, do not look at the haram. For someone who does not wear the hijab on these couple of days, wherever you go, and wear proper hijab, like no makeup, nothing, you know, properly. On that day, don't have any arrogance in your heart. Treat people with humility, with kindness, with humbleness. Be respectful, be kind. Give sadaqah in the name of Imam al-Mahdi al-Muntadhar ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif. Try these things. That would be a great form of worship, of seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because now you're implementing the teachings of the dua to seeking the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through your actions. So on these couple of days, the days of Arafah and Eid, try to not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you forget, you make a mistake, you commit a sin, immediately do istighfar and try not to go back to it again.
Thank you, Sheikh. Another question is, the verse which you were mentioning earlier from Surah Nisa about the Prophet praying for the people, can we use this verse to prove that the importance of the Prophet being a medium, a wasila?
Absolutely. What's important about this verse is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, and when they commit a sin or oppress themselves, Allah uses, وَإِنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ, and when they commit a sin or oppress themselves, and by oppressing themselves means committing a sin, because you're not being fair to yourself, because yourself has a right upon you, and that right is to obey Allah. So when you abuse that right, you've basically have oppressed yourself. ظُلْم. Anyways, وَإِنَّهُمْ إِذْ ظَلَمُوا أَنفُسَهُمْ, they come to you, Ya Rasulullah. So they come to you. Second is fastaghfirullah. So they do istighfar, meaning that they don't just come to you and say, you ask Allah for forgiveness, but I'm not willing to change. Rather, no, I come to you, Ya Rasulullah. I am seeking Allah's forgiveness. Yani I am willing to change. I'm not going to go back. Tawbatan nasuha. So I'm seeking tawbah, forgiveness. And then, wastaghfara. Wawawul atf here. وَاسْتَغْفَرَ لَهُمُ الرَّسُولُ, and the messenger seeking forgiveness for them, they would find Allah all forgiving, all merciful. Why did Allah have to add the messenger in there doing istighfar? And we read in the ziyarah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, and I have come to you so that you would seek forgiveness for me. And you do istighfar for me. In the ziyarah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. Even the ziyarah from a distance. There is a ziyarah from far away to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. We read this as well. Meaning, I am turning. So ja'uka, not necessarily physically they come to you. Obviously, they come to you physically if you can. You can go to Medina, to the qabr of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi. That'll be fantastic. That'll be great. Because there are places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to be worshipped from and asked from. And one of them is, of course, the Masjid al-Nabawi. And other places are, for example, the shrines of the Ma'sumin alayhim as-salam. In fact, we have a hadith. Al-Imam al-Hadi, salamullah alayhi, when he was in Samarra, he became ill. He paid money to somebody, told him, go give this money to so-and-so. Ask him to go to Karbala and pray for me at the grave of my grandfather, al-Imam al-Husayn, salamullah alayhi. So this person asked him, aren't you an imam? He said, yes, I am an imam. So I said, why don't you pray? He said, well, there are places where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves to be prayed from and asked from. And one of them is the qabr of my grandfather, al-Imam al-Husayn, salamullah alayhi. So send someone there to pray for me. Imagine, al-Imam al-Hadi, who's Imamun Ma'soom, pays money, asks someone to go to Karbala, to the qabr of al-Imam al-Husayn, and pray for him. And people still question, can we do tawassul? Can we ask? Of course. So the Prophet has this great status before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that our istighfar, our asking of forgiveness and gaining forgiveness needs to be coupled with the Prophet asking istighfar for us, so that inshallah Allah will forgive us. Yani we need the intercession of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi to have the shafa'ah, to have the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we find an example of that in Surah Yusuf. The children of Ya'qub alayhi salam, they went to him after they were discovered, and then they realized their mistake towards the end of the surah and the story. And they went to their father and said, Ya Abana staghfir lana Rabbana. Our father, seek forgiveness for us from our Lord. Ya'qub alayhi salam said to them, I'll do so. Why didn't he just say, oh, you go do istighfar, Allah will answer you, you don't need me? No, because he is a prophet of Allah, he's waliyullah. He has that status before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, they asked him and he said, I will do so. I will pray for you. So we go and we turn to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi and the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam, and we ask them to pray for us. Indeed, they have such a great high status. We don't even recognize the status of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. Read Ziyar al-Jami' al-Kabira and try to reflect upon its meaning to have some understanding of the greatness of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. In addition, there is a hadith from Imam al-Rida salamullah alayhi with a man called Abdul Aziz ibn Muslim, where he talks about imamah. And that hadith is found in Uyun Akhbar al-Rida, the book by Sheikh As-Saduq radwanullahi ta'ala alayh. You'll see the status of imamah. It is something that cannot be comprehended. It's beyond us to realize the greatness of the ma'soom, the imamah. And the Prophet says, I was a prophet while Adam was not created yet. So what does that hadith mean? How can we understand this? The noor of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi was there. What is that noor? We read in Ziyar al-Warith, Ashhadu annaka kunta nooran. Ya Imam Hussein, you were noor, noor. Fil aslab al-shamikha. So what does that noor mean? What is that nooraniya? The noorani aspect, the lighting aspect of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. So indeed, they have such a great high status, and we should not undermine the status of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam.
Asant, thank you. I'm showing one more question in the queue. Did Imam Hussein alayhi salam recite this dua when he was on the Hajj, where he left early for Karbala, or was this dua recited in a previous Hajj?
This was in a previous Hajj, because the Hajj that he left towards Karbala, remember, he did not complete the Hajj. He left the day of Tarwiyah. Tarwiyah means on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah. On the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, before Arafah, he changed his Hajj, his niyyah, from Hajj to Umrah. So he finished his Umrah and he left. So therefore, that and the year, you're talking about the year 60 after Hijrah. So in the year 60 after Hijrah, Imam al-Hussein salamullah did not perform a Hajj in that year. He left on the 8th of Dhul Hijjah, so a day before the day of Arafah. And he left. So he could not have recited that dua on that year, the year 60. So this was recited sometime, some of the historians think, sometime after the martyrdom of Imam al-Hassan salamullahi alayhi. So sometime between the year 50 and the year 59 after Hijrah. Within these 5 years, 9 years, sorry, sometime during this time, he recited this dua.
Thank you, Sheikh. I'm not seeing any more questions, so maybe we'll stop here. Sheikh, I hope you remember all of us in your du'as on the day of Arafat, on the day of Eid. We're definitely going to remember you. This was really useful, really helpful, and we all really appreciate your time here with us on this day. Thank you, Sheikh.
May Allah bless you all, inshallah. Jazakum Allah khaira. Thank you very much for having this session. Indeed, it's an important session as we gain knowledge from Al-Imam Al-Hussein salamullahi alayhi about better understanding our relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and with the ma'sumeen alayhim as-salam. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase in our hidayah, in our guidance, such that we attain his pleasure, inshallah, and be among the companions of Al-Imam Al-Mahdi Al-Muntadhar ajalallahu ta'ala farajahu al-sharif, as we read in Ziyarat Warith, when we recite the ziyarah of the companions, we say, فَيَا لَيْتَنِي كُنْتُ مَعَكُمْ أفوز معكم. I wish I was there with you so that I would have victory with you. That victory requires effort, requires work, requires submission to Allah, obedience to Allah. It requires us to have good akhlaq, good manners. Requires us to the best of our ability to always think and ask ourselves, this action I'm about to do, how am I going to answer this to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment? This action I'm about to do, is it going to attain the pleasure of Imam al-Mahdi alayhi salam? When he asks me, when I, for example, join him and he says, you did so and so, can I answer that? So try to always be in the obedience of Ahlul Bayt alayhi salam. And if I may request the mu'mineen to join me in reciting this dua for hastening the reappearance of our Imam alayhi salam, especially this coming Friday, which is going to be the day of Eid, Eidul Adha. Pray for Allah, to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to hasten the reappearance of our Imam. Pray, pray, continue praying, even on the day of Arafah. Pray to the Imam, for the Imam salamullah alayhi, so that Allah hastens his reappearance, inshaAllah. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد اللهم كل وليك الحجة ابن الحسن صلواتك عليه وعلى آبائه في هذه الساعة وفي كل ساعة وليا وحافظا وقائدا وناصرا ودليلا وعينا حتى تسكنه أرضك طوعا وتمتعه فيها طويلا برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين وصل اللهم على محمد وآله الطاهرين اللهم صل على محمد Thank you.
Hassan, thank you, Kadhafis, and everyone, thank you for joining. And we've heard Sheikh's call to action, so don't forget the Imam on the day. Thank you again, Sheikh. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Thank you.